Welcome, everyone. I'm Kevin Crook. This is Blake Moss. We're talking about scalable event-driven infrastructure for multi-cloud environments.
So I'm Blake Moss. I'm a graduate student at BYU studying computer science. I also work as a security engineer in the CES Security Operations Center at BYU. My main focus is on event-driven systems. I also do data science. I'm from Boise, Idaho, and this is my wife and our new baby. She is 5 weeks old, so we love to party at night. We're up all night partying. Yeah.
I'm Kevin Crook. I'm an undergraduate in cybersecurity at BYU. So I have done a whole lot of specializing into cloud infrastructure. And I'm from Wyoming, and I just got to say, there's more people in this room than there is in my home state. So we're going to take a little bit of a journey through this presentation. The process of improving infrastructure principles to help security be more effective is our main focus. We're going to start with the dark ages, talk about some principles that we found along the way that really worked for us, and talk about how we implemented those things in practice. So we start in the dark ages. So it used to be, and it is still today, that you would need to VPN in or connect to a box, SSH, and Vim a file to configure something. Or, I don't know if you've ever had this experience, but spending hours upon hours debugging a system that was patched, that was supposed to be working just fine, and for some reason it's not. Or you're dealing with an application that was built maybe a decade before you actually entered the job, and now you have to maintain it and possibly even make new features for it.
So going along with that, when we talk about security engineering or engineering the systems that are going to help enable the security operations, one of the big problems is the manual monitoring, right? So having to go through, like Kevin said, log into the system, see what's going on, maybe grub through the logs, and not have very good insight into the different events that are occurring in your ecosystem. Polling-based tools as well. We know that they're inefficient when it comes to dealing with the actual domain of cybersecurity. Security events are coming asynchronous. The bad guys aren't attacking on a schedule of every 5 minutes, right? They're attacking at all different times. The signal is very mixed. And polling-based resources aren't the most efficient to deal with that problem. And then going along with that, vendor mashup. So I'm sure many of you know there's a lot of really awesome security tools that are produced by multiple companies. However, when it comes to integrating those tools together in your, let's say, in your SOC, it can be very difficult. It seems like sometimes the vendors have it out for each other. They don't want you to integrate. And that can be an issue when it comes to trying to make the most of all those different tools and all that money you're spending on those different tools.
We're not endorsing changing light bulbs with drones, by the way, although it would be pretty cool. So we were struggling with a lot of these things that we just talked about, these challenges, and we had a really good engineering meeting, and everything changed for the rest of time. I don't know if you want to.
Yeah, so I was kind of the cause probably of this particular meeting. I had tried to update one of our systems that could kind of be considered like a monolith application. It did a lot of the functionality that we needed to do our security operations. I tried to perform like an update on this. We were trying to move kind of to a better platform, and everything broke. And because everything broke, because of the monolith structure that we had, there was significant downtime in our operations. And so our boss graciously said, like, that's it. We need to rethink how we're doing things, and we need to kind of come up with a better architecture to handle the asynchronous nature of security, as well as being more flexible so that we don't have this like massive fail when it comes to updating like a single system.
I tried to get a screenshot of the existing system that we had when some of these bad things went down. The problem is the PHP application that we used to use was accidentally maliciously burned, so I had to settle for this meme instead. So as a result of some of the mistakes that we've made and the awesome things that we learned along the way, we got together as engineers and we decided on a foundation of principles that we said we're gonna base our infrastructure on these things. First of all, infrastructure as code. So a lot of these things are really common among software development, but they're not so common in security. Basically, for those that aren't familiar with infrastructure as code, it's like you can look at a GitHub repo and see what your infrastructure is supposed to look like. It's really great because you can take a certain state and you can duplicate it, or you can update it and iterate on it. And it's really stable because you know exactly what's going on with the stack. Then comes in containerization. So from the little diagram that we have on the right, it used to be that a lot of times you have applications running on the bare hardware of a server or like on a virtual machine. The problem is you got all these things getting entangled, the configuration of the application, and then the actual like meat of the application, the logic. And then you've got all these dependencies that are floating around on the operating system that sometimes work when you patch, sometimes get broken when you patch, and that can cause a lot of problems. So the idea is, instead of just throwing your applications onto a virtual machine, you encapsulate them into a container, like a Docker or a Rocket container. They're a lot more flexible in that it gives you a level of protection against patching issues and allows you to put them in the cloud or on-prem, and it's very flexible and adaptable to what you're doing. And then software versioning. When you're dealing with an application and adding features, patching it, a lot of times it's hard to know when something was implemented, and if something goes wrong, it's hard to backtrack. So this is a really basic principle that saves you a whole lot of time, especially if you're, like in the diagram, dealing with like two different sites or two different teams that are using different versions of the application. It's really great to be able to track those changes and see what features are being used where, so you have a little bit more insight into what's going on in your security infrastructure.
So, talking about infrastructure as code, like Kevin mentioned, it's a great way to be able to break down your infrastructure into kind of a readable template that you can see and you can distribute to other places. However, one of the problems with that is it in itself can become kind of a monolith application. You can have all your infrastructure for your whole ecosystem defined in a single, let's say, Terraform file. And everything relies on that Terraform file. And if something goes wrong with the state file, then your infrastructure is in trouble. So one of the principles that we decided was that we were going to break up our infrastructure as code into different lightweight stacks. So each application had its own like Terraform stack, its Terraform files that we could then develop. We wouldn't have to have if somebody was doing work on one particular part, one particular subsystem of our infrastructure. They could do that in parallel as another person was working on a different subsystem. It wasn't all tied together in a single infrastructure as code template. We broke it out into these lightweight stacks. And that's helped improve our flexibility. Next is decoupled infrastructure. So kind of what we talked about, not having this massive fail that comes from the impact of one system. So having a decoupled infrastructure means that if one subsystem goes down, the entire functionality of our ecosystem, of our infrastructure, is not going to go down with it. That there still is going to be some functionality maintained because these services don't directly depend on each other, right? They're broken out into these logical microservices, which is the next slide. So our microservice infrastructure that we have, instead of having this monolith application that we go to for every single piece of our security operations functionality, we have broken it down into various microservices that are really good at performing one function. Now, what that function is more of an art than a science, which we'll talk about later. But the basic idea is that one microservice is going to be really good at doing one particular thing. We're not going to have this monolith application that handles everything. So we've kind of decoupled the functionality into those different microservices. And then event-driven. So naturally, like I just talked about, security events, they come at all times in all different sizes. Our analyst time is valuable, and so we don't want to use inefficient means to raise these events or to handle these events. We want to be able to do it in a design that fits the domain, which is event-driven when it comes to security. You can see this first graph here. This is not a realistic picture of different security events occurring. We have like maybe the number of port scanning alerts coming in and the number of SQL injection attempts. And you can see here, this doesn't look very realistic, right? This is occurring there's like five events occurring every 5 minutes or every hour. And this is not a realistic picture of security. Security events look much more like this, where the signal's very mixed. We have a lot of different events occurring at all different times, and we need an efficient way to be able to raise those events and consume those events, not a polling-based method that's gonna, you know, sit there for 5 minutes, sit there for another 5 minutes. We want immediate action taken on these events. So just as kind of an analogy, and I'll move over here. So like I said, we have a 5-week-old baby. And so I thought this would be a good analogy to kind of explain the difference between event-driven and command-driven, or the type of method paradigm we were using before. So what was that? Yeah, my wife actually helped me come up with this. So my wife is very much an example of like an event-driven service. So if the baby has an event, that messy diaper event, right? My wife will consume that event and she'll be able to handle it. She'll just take care of it. She'll change the diaper, get the diaper cream on, get the old diaper thrown away, and we're all good to go, right? That event has been handled by the wife service. Now, in comparison, this is me, Blake's service. I'm very much more of a command-driven service. So this is going to be a very inefficient way to handle the diaper change. So in order to make this service work, the baby will have to send a request that says, okay, I'm smelly, right? There's something smelly going on. And then she'll wait for a response, like a polling-based response, and I'll send back timeout. Maybe I'm like not paying attention. I'm like reading a book or like watching a show. Not very attentive, right? So then baby has to send another request, okay? Serious attention. I'm crying loud. Crying very loud. The baby is upset. And I respond back, unknown. I don't know how do I handle that method. Is she hungry? I'm not sure. Again, like very inefficient. And then finally, it's too late. A blowout has occurred, and my service is gonna go down. Kernel panic, right? There's an issue, and I'll have to have my wife come, you know, perform maintenance on me and the baby at that point in time. So this is an example of a command-driven paradigm. Very inefficient. When we talk about security events, we don't want a system that continually has to reach out and say, oh, did this happen yet? Oh, it didn't happen yet. Oh, this happened yet. We want systems that can be asynchronous and respond to events as they happen and take care of that event, consume that event and take care of it.
And then finally, the last principle is continuous integration, continuous deployment. We talk, this is a common term in software engineering, but especially for our security infrastructure, at least that we've been working on, we realized this principle is particularly important because we have updates that come up all the time. Things change, we need to add alerts, we need to add different functionalities to our systems. And updating all those things manually can be a huge pain, and it is a huge pain. It's very inefficient, takes a lot of time. And so using principles of continuous integration, continuous deployment, means that we can really make our engineering time most valuable. We have automated steps to enforce certain policies on our code and on our different services. And we really try to mitigate the human error that can occur when it comes to updating these different systems.
So this is a fairly rough paraphrase of C.S. Lewis, but we're sure he would say this today about security infrastructure. As we work to implement these awesome principles, we found that, wow, we have a lot of work to do. Doing this isn't trivial. So we're going to go over a couple of the challenges that we faced and probably you face as you're working with your security infrastructure. The first being policies. When you're working with a single team, you've got really great simplicity in your policy, but as you work with multiple organizations, you start getting all these conflicting policies, and it compounds in complexity. Like when you're trying to create passwords for a site, and all of a sudden it won't let you have more than 12 characters, or it has some absurd requirement. And as you're dealing with these different environments, you find that they're using different technologies. That's really great for them, but it complicates our process because we're responsible for securing their stuff. If their stuff is so different than everybody else's, we have to pay special attention. And when you have to pay special attention to something, it distracts you from finding the bad guys. You might have people that are dealing with all cloud or partially on cloud, or they're all on-prem. And finally, with networking, a lot of times you run into issues where, your client uses a proxy and you have to design your application to work with that, or you have problems with network reliability or speed limitations.
So another challenge is personnel, the people that you're going to be dealing with, because at the end of the day, it doesn't matter how cool your systems are, they need to work with the personnel that you have available. And people can make mistakes. People do make mistakes, and training is hard to do. New tech especially is difficult to implement because it takes a long time to adopt. People get used to a certain way of doing things, a certain mode, and they're comfortable with that. That becomes kind of the norm. So trying to get away from that and maybe adopt something that's better can be difficult.
Gotta watch that computer disappear one more time. It's really satisfying.
Okay, it's gone. Linda's my mom's name too, so that's kind of funny. So vendor products, like we talked about, there's a big mismatch between especially enterprise-grade products, you know, the products you pay a lot of money for. There can be a big, big mismatch between how do we integrate, you know, this particular system with this system. It was made by this vendor. It supports, or it has these requirements. This one has this requirements and interacts in this way. And so the vendor product mismatch can be a challenge, especially when you want to synthesize security events across your different systems. That could be an issue. And then scalability, right? We want to make sure that our applications can run at scale. That way, as security operations increase, or as you take on more responsibilities, more load, more events, Your applications are going to be able to handle that and scale in response. So this is, yeah. And then we're going to, no, you're good. Yeah, so now we're going to talk about, so given those principles that we've talked about before and the challenges that we were facing, we're going to talk a little bit about our approach to how we try to tackle those different problems. So what we don't want is something that looks like this. I saw this tweet as we were working on this architecture, and it seemed like very, very applicable to us. So this is like what somebody expects to find when the organization has this containerized microservice, like all the buzzwords thrown in there, multi-cloud. And this is what we don't want. We don't want a system that's just a ton of different services, this web of dependencies, and a very complicated infrastructure. We want to maintain the simplicity while also enhancing the functionality. So the first thing we did was to look at how we were actually going to design these specific microservices. So for our event-driven system, we use a publish and subscribe model. So event-driven microservices can produce events, and they also can consume events. But that can get pretty hairy fast, especially if you are not on the same page with your other team members as to what events are going to be in your ecosystem, what events are not. So defining an event catalog was really important for us to understand, okay, these are the events that are going to be running through our different our infrastructure. This is what they mean. This is what services are producing this event. This is what services are supposed to consume the event. And maintaining this event catalog helps people right off the bat understand, okay, this is these are the different events that are occurring, and this is how I can handle them. A central event broker is what mediates the connections between those different services. And again, like we talked about, each microservice is accomplishing one particular business function. And that is more of an art than a science. It takes collaboration with your team members to decide what that function is going to be, and it could be specific to the particular objective you're trying to accomplish. So we could have a microservice that's really good at doing our ETLs for our vSphere inventory, or getting all of our VMware or our virtual machine inventory. Or another microservice that's very good at performing local intelligence lookups to make sure, like, if I have a particular IP address I see, I can pull local intelligence data from that. Similarly, a microservice that responds just with our instant response platform and is able to communicate with our instant response platform, raising events and consuming events from there.
So as we talked about with containers, they have a lot of advantages over running things directly on the server. So this is something that's been done in industry for, I think, almost a decade now. So when we were deciding on how we would use containers, we thought about the language that we would be writing the applications in. We decided to settle on Python, because it's pretty flexible. It doesn't do everything like super well, but it does most things like pretty well, and it's pretty easy to learn. This allows our microservices to be easy to write, and then because they're containerized, we can put them in the cloud or say, oh, we can't access that from the cloud. Let's put it on-prem. They're really flexible that way. By defining them using infrastructure as code, it's as simple as just changing a little bit of code on your computer and then deploying it. It allows for a minimal footprint. So say you're dealing with a company or an organization that doesn't want to necessarily devote their whole data center just for your security application. By using containers, you're able to use a lot less of a footprint than like a VM. What's really nice, something that we worked with is a problem that I've seen in industry is the difficulty of getting secrets into a container. By using hybrid cloud environments, you're able to work with the containers to get those sensitive secrets out of a centralized store.
So then, how we implemented our CI/CD pipeline, particularly for these event-driven microservices and other microservices that we have in our infrastructure, we really tried to apply those principles of CI/CD that we talked about previously, namely that we enforce style and security standards across the board. So we have different tools to make sure that, you know, hopefully the security team's code is not going to be super vulnerable. So we make sure that we have tools in place to check that and make sure there aren't any gaping vulnerabilities in our code, as well as enforce style so that we can have consistency across the team of, okay, this is how we write these particular things. This is the kind of documentation in the code that we need. This is the structure that we're using. Automated semantic versioning and code releases. So when a particular code repository is updated, it goes through our CI process and a new release with the semantic versioning is created. That way there's not confusion as to, oh, did I label this with the new release or do I label it with the old version or like how do I, it's all automated. And so once a particular update appears in our code, the new release is formed. And then centralized testing and build instructions. So instead of having a test instruction and a build instruction for each particular microservice, they reference a centralized document that has those build instructions and test instructions there. So that way, if we need to make additional changes, let's say we need to add another security check to all of our different microservices, we can do that at one centralized place. And then once the CI process goes through and the container is built, or the image is built, that image is then pushed to a private registry, which we can then reference in our infrastructure's code templates to deploy pretty much with one click. So if a version changes and we need to update that version across multiple systems and even across multiple environments, multiple locations across the world, we can do that just with updating the version number in our Terraform code and redeploying that.
So an issue sometimes, well, a lot of times, with security infrastructure is the policies and processes can be so complicated for users that sometimes they just don't use it. So we spent a lot of time and attention trying to make sure that our stack was easy to use so that we could hire on an intern or bring in a new hire, and they'd be able to quickly, within like a day or two, get up and running and interacting, building things for our infrastructure. So in order to do that, we abstracted a lot of the complicated interactions with the event, centralized event hub, so that the developer just has to call send a message, and then it deals with everything there. And then we have a common configuration structure so that all they have to do is say, okay, I need this secret, and I am in this organization. They put it into a configuration file, and based on that config, the microservice is able to go off into the place where it's going to work, and it knows everything that it needs to do based on just a few little lines that the programmer put in. They don't need to know everything about the proxy. They don't need to know anything about what's going on with their security policy. The microservice will behave in that environment in the way it's supposed to. Now, this can't be done completely through just abstracting things. You have to work a lot with documentation. So a lot of times we take a Friday and we just work together and collaborate on the documentation, read each other's documentation and say, hey, this doesn't make any sense to me. I tried this out and it did not work. And then from that point, we worked to find indicators for when microservices are not behaving properly. and they're able to give us feedback and say, hey, I can't connect to the internet. Hey, I'm dying here. Do something to help me. And it helps to ease the burden of maintenance on the security infrastructure so that the analysts and the engineers can work on what they like doing. There's a really great book, Design of Everyday Things, that this quote is from. But quite honestly, if you can build the most amazing security stack in the world, but if people don't understand how to use it, they're not going to use it. There was in this book, he gives a really great example of a security conference that he went to on Google campus, where they had the whole badge in, the whole spiel, where it was super secure, and the conference was taking place outside of the secure environment. Problem is, they didn't think to put the bathrooms outside the secure environment. So what happened is they ended up just putting a doorstop into the secure environment, and the attendees were allowed access into the secure environment. All that thought, all that security, the badging in, all the biometric stuff, and it was defeated by a doorstop. So we really focused on trying to abstract these tools so that anyone could use them. So a quick example, something that we worked a lot with was trying to find a way for our analysts to easily consume the tools that we were designing and building for them. And a lot of times at work you use like Teams or Slack or these chat applications to communicate with each other. Why not just have a bot there that they can talk to? So that's something that we started working with. So here's a quick example of just a prototype. A lot of these existing Slack bots have a lot of features, like QBot or AirBot. They're able to talk to like HipChat and all these different really cool services. The problem is they weren't really being maintained, so we were able to build something really small and lightweight that is really easy to configure. Just using our chat application's front end. We didn't have to write any of the front end for our security stack. It was already written for us. So using a lot of the features with the Slack API, we were able to create little buttons that pop up in the chat. And as you can see, the analyst can just pop into their chat window, say, hey, look up. And it'll give them the options. Okay, you can look up an IP, you can look up a MAC address. And when they click that button, hey, there's a custom form. So say I want to quarantine a system. This is, in most places, a multi-step process. So the idea is that the analyst knows basically what they need, but they don't necessarily know where to put it, or having it all in one place, all labeled and described to them is really awesome because they don't have to think about it. They can work through it and then go to the other thing that demands their attention. You can even put in little drop-down menus. So this makes it really easy for This makes it really easy to take a rather complicated process like blocking something or raising an incident, something that is you usually have to go to another website or something, another service. That's my last slide. That's how we went around trying to abstract the security infrastructure.
And one unique thing, because we talked about those principles at the beginning, this particular, you can think of this as a microservice. So it has a CI/CD pipeline that we built out that accomplishes those tasks that we listed before. It's also event-driven. So it's unique in the fact that we work based on events. So this isn't just a system that, you know, gets the thing from Slack and then has to do this manual interaction with our quarantine system. It'll actually just produce an event, a quarantine event, that will be picked up by another microservice in our ecosystem. And that microservice can exist in multiple different locations. So imagine we have, let's say, three different sites, each with their own network, each with their own quarantine process. We can have three of these quarantine microservices listening for events that are pertinent to them, listening for quarantine events. This Slack bot here, when you click that submit button, it's not just going to do some manual interaction with a quarantine system in one place. It's going to raise an event to our centralized broker, which is going to then be consumed by those three different microservices, those three different quarantine microservices at the different sites, right? And so this is a different way of doing things. This is an event-driven way of doing our security operations that is much more flexible, right? All we need is the outbound connection from those microservices to our centralized event broker, and we can perform security operations across disparate locations asynchronously with the design that fits the real domain. So this is kind of a unique just front-end instance. A lot of our things are more back-end, not visually like accessible. But this is an example of a service that when a user clicks that submit, it will raise that event, and the microservices that are interested in that event will be able to consume it and respond appropriately. Yeah, so I know we finished a little bit early, but this has been a really interesting challenge for us, especially as students. This has been something that we've really appreciated the opportunity to work on. It's not every day that as students you'll get to work on some critical pieces of infrastructure in a SOC. So we really appreciated this opportunity, and it's far from over. We're still working out some of the kinks, but the initial results that we've seen from implementing this design have been really positive. Especially as we've done reviews with different architects and engineers. We feel like this going forward is the way that will enable us and really enable anybody who wants to adopt that event-driven design to increase their security functionality while improving flexibility across your SOC. So thank you very much, and we'd love to answer any questions.
I think a big part of it there was a talk at the keynote of Black Hat where they talked about kind of software is eating the world and how that applies to security and security engineering. I think adopting some of the approaches of software engineering is particularly helpful because there's no going kind of back from the dark ages, at least. Everything is moving towards the software-centric system. Even security engineering is moving towards that. So adopting the best practices and principles, and then combining that with domain expertise and in your experience as security professionals, I feel like that is probably the most potent combination to handling the challenges today. Does that answer your question? Yeah.
A lot of what's happening in the industry, moving toward more of a cloud, more of a hybrid environment, our security also needs to change in step with that. And I feel that a lot of that needs to happen with a better communication between software development principles and security principles. I think overall, if we kind of break down those barriers and help to inform software development more of security things and take some of the principles from software development into security, we'll see a lot more effective security infrastructure.
sorry, just to add on to that, a lot of the times we think of security as like the people who kind of respond to the negative, saying, no, we can't do this because, you know, this is insecure. Like, we can't do it this way because of this, or our policies constrict you to this. But I think also looking at kind of the paradigm where, like, I referenced that Black Hat keynote again, where they kind of adopted the principle of trying to say yes, of exploring different ways of doing things, that it's not just the standard, the norm of how we did security operations 10 years ago or 5 years ago, but that we adapt as the technology adapts and in implementing these best practices of software engineering, and really can be best practices of security engineering as well.
Yeah, this is related, but as we work through some of these design books and DevOps books, something that we really found is a lot of these best practices are really awesome. There needs to be a little bit of leeway, though, in some of the principles. So, for example, you can look at trying to create your entire infrastructure as one microservice does one function and things like that, but you also have to be able to give and take a little bit, because sometimes as we work through building these services, the microservices became really chatty. So, like, we'd have two services that were, like, joined at the hip, just talking to each other like crazy. They were independent services. They were decoupled. But you have to think about your domain and think practically about the best practices as you work through them. And honestly, the best way to do it is just to start with some of these principles and iterate on your infrastructure and be willing to make mistakes, try new things, and see what works for your organization.
Any other questions? All right. Well, yeah. Yeah, so this is, that's a great point. This has kind of been an in-house project. Oh, what was that? Sorry. The question was, do we collaborate with our software engineering team to develop these microservices and to maintain them? And the answer, at least for right now, this has been mostly an in-house project between our security engineering team. But this is a great point, and we would look forward to future to collaboration with software engineers to go through the code review process and to work together. I sometimes like, there's sometimes a disparity between the security team or the software people, or, there's kind of a siloed off, but something that we're going to do definitely in the future is to kind of collaborate together to make the best microservices and to really make the most efficient microservices for our domain.
Yeah. You do end up consuming a lot of other team services in a large organization. So naturally you end up working with a lot of the development teams to show them what isn't working and how to integrate systems in a more secure way.
All right. Well, thank you so much for coming. We really appreciate it. Have a great rest of your conference.